we face as we address the challenges and changes in relationships in our lives are perfectly predictable. As children grow up and become more independent, there's that struggle that parents and children experience. Mom and dad, parents wanting to hang on, and children desperately vying for the freedom that they need to find their own way. I wouldn't know anything about that at all. Matter of fact, my children gave me a Father's Day card, which is so perfectly appropriate for me. There's a picture of a father that says, having a child is like having a piece of your own body living in the world outside you. And then you flip the page and it says, doing stupid stuff you told it not to do. Yes, my children pick that out quickly and easily. But then you also think of empty nesters. What do they do when the children are gone and the house is quiet and that emptiness is felt? Having served in military towns, I saw couples really struggle when the sailor would return home after 6 months on an aircraft carrier. The sailor wanted to plunge back into family life and order all sorts of directions, make the sailor's wishes known. And the family that's managed very well for 6 months on their own usually replies, "Who do you think you are? We've gotten along just fine. Thank you very much." And then you think about retirement. When couples are no longer as individuals going out into the world for 8 hours a day, they find themselves at home looking at one another, wondering what life is going to be like forever. My father-in-law, in retirement, now drives for Uber. Not because he needs the money, but for his marriage to remain intact, he has to get out of the house. Now, these shifting dynamics pervade so much of our lives. And as we think about the challenges and changes we face in life and consider the prevalence of addiction that has become so real and so personal for so many of us, we have to recognize that that dynamic is there as well. Oftentimes, when a friend or a family member enters recovery, there's great rejoicing in the family, in the circle of friends, and in the larger community, because they had this vision of the one becoming healthy, being restored to normal life, whatever that looks like for any of us. And expect that person to be there in the way that they haven't been, and to be present in a way that they haven't been for a long, long time. But what does the recovering person have to do? Well, the individual has to work a program. The individual has to be almost singularly focused on recovery, to hang on to sobriety, to become truly sober and not just free of drugs and alcohol, to engage in that healthy, full life, to have anything to give anyone. Sobriety has to come first. Now imagine what that feels like in a family. The prodigal child, the prodigal spouse is returning home. And you want that person to be there. But that person might have to go to a meeting focused on recovery once a day to stay sober. That person might have to go to 2 meetings a day to stay sober. That same person might have to develop a relationship with a mentor. And they might have to spend an hour a day with that person, talking about the challenges they face that threaten their sobriety. So the celebration can oftentimes turn into resentment. But the recovering person, to be able to give family, friends, or community anything, has to drink deeply from the well and the spring of sobriety. And it's only through that that the recovering person can offer anyone else anything. In the gospel lesson, Jesus is pointing to a very similar kind of dynamic. Now, we hear his words as harsh when he talks about bearing a sword of fire and dividing families into, testing the loyalty of families, claiming that one member of a family of 5 that will dedicate themselves to him and his father's love. And Jesus says in this scripture that that's the most important thing. That's the central thing. That relationship with God overrides all of our other relationships. That's a hard message to hear. Bet you wish I were preaching politics this morning instead. But I'm preaching the Bible. Don't forget that. You think about the 10 commandments back here behind the altar. The first half of them deal with one's relationship to God and one's commitment to God. It's only after you get through that first half that you talk about honoring your father and mother, and you talk about the sanctity of the marriage relationship. That only comes after the articulation of the covenant that we are in with God. Now relax. Jesus isn't anti-family. What Jesus points to is the reality of our lives and our relationships with God and one another. Jesus essentially says, to have anything for anyone else, you must know me. You must know my son. You must know the Spirit. You have to look at the teaching and the healing that Jesus offered. Because Jesus poured himself out sacrificially to all of those that he encountered in the name of love. And if you don't know that sort of sacrificial love, then you don't know God. And you don't know love. And how can you pour yourselves out for those primary, essential relationships that you have? You have to have something before you can give it away. You have to know something before you can share it. Point is that there is a source for all that we have in life and all that we are in life and all that surrounds us. And there is a source for love. There is a source of compassion. There is a source of mercy. And that source, that well, that spring is God. Drink that water. Let that water quench your thirst. And you just might be able to help others drink that water and be satiated and satisfied forever. Friends, this isn't just encouragement from Jesus. Not just encouragement. Friends, this is a demand. This is what God demands of us. And if we are going to be faithful, if we are going to live true to God's word, if we're going to ensconce ourselves in the biblical witness, we have to respond to the demand. The good news, the life-saving news, is that one has gone before us to show us how to do it. Jesus Christ, the only and eternal Son of God.